Hello, this is Ezekiel O'Callaghan with Raptor Chatter, this time for August 2018 in review for Paleontology. Starting off, we have a series of pentadactyl tracks from the Triassic. We have penta meaning five and dactyl meaning finger, so these are five-toed footprints from the Triassic. Specifically, the paper looked at how the maker of the tracks would have been able to cross land and how effective that movement would have been, finding that it was less effective than other modes of transportation that had evolved during the time, notably the dinosaurian three-toed tridactyl foot, which was able to cover land much quicker and helped to lead to the dinosaurs' rise after the Triassic. Edicarians are some of the first life on the planet, coming from a period before the Cambrian explosion. And while it's been believed that these species helped lead directly to the species that evolved during the Cambrian explosion, there had been nothing that had definitively connected the two. The species Stromatovarus was one of the leftovers from the Edicarian period that persisted partially into the Cambrian, and the study of it and its body helped to define it as a specific species of the kingdom Animalia, meaning that there is a connection between the previous Edicarians and the life that came after the Cambrian explosion. Helping us to understand how life was able to evolve into such complex forms, including some of the ones we see today. Hallucigenia is one of the most iconic species coming out of the Burgess Shale of British Columbia, Canada, and now its relative, Thanahita, has been described from Herefordshire in England. The specimen was so finely preserved that scientists were able to use 3D modeling techniques to show how similar the species is to things like the modern-day velvet worm, and helps us to understand how the species was able to become one of the first modern ones to arise and not go extinct over 400 million years. A new paper casts doubt onto how well Spinosaurus would actually be able to swim. Specifically, the paper uses the Ibrahim et al. Model that was created in 2014 for Spinosaurus, and compares that with models of species like crocodiles and alligators to figure out what kind of buoyancy Spinosaurus would have had. The study found that Spinosaurus lacked the buoyancy necessary to allow it to dive well, and that likely means that it wasn't a fully aquatic hunting predator. The Ibrahim study holds the position that Spinosaurus would have had to walk around on all fours in order to move around. This has come under doubt by many paleontologists, such as Mark Whitten, who shows the bipedal stance that most paleontologists still believe Spinosaurus had. And so despite this paper's idea that Spinosaurus couldn't swim very well, all the other evidence we have for Spinosaurus very much suggests it was still an aquatic species, or at least semi-aquatic, potentially being somewhat like a heron, resting on riverbanks and pulling fish from the river itself. The paper and the debate surrounding Spinosaurus also goes to show the necessary collaboration and openness for ideas that is necessary for paleontology to succeed as a science, and how this collaboration can help us get a better understanding of our past. The giant relatives to dragonflies from the Carboniferous are known for being the largest insects of all time, with some of these dragonflies having a wingspan of over 3 feet. Species like Meganeura and Meganeurites were long believed to have been flying through the dense jungles and forests of the Carboniferous period, but a new paper has shed doubt on that idea. Like the wings of modern-day dragonflies, the wings of these ancient dragonflies were very fragile, which isn't exactly conducive to flying through densely wooded forests. In order to reinforce this idea that they couldn't fly through these dense forests, the study looked at Meganeurite's eye, finding that it had become greatly enlarged, helping it in more long-distance vision. This is the same kind of adaptation in eye that we see in modern-day dragonflies, which lay in open areas, perching and watching for their prey to fly by, before launching from their perch and catching it while on the wing. The Alverezsaurs are some of those strangest dinosaurs that we have, with species like Mononychus best showing this, with mono meaning single, nychus meaning claw. And this is not a single claw on the foot, such as in raptors, but rather a single claw on its very short hands. Debate about the origin of this single claw continues, however most of it is based around the idea that it was using it to help it forage for grubs that would be hiding under pieces of rotting wood, or other similar small insects and bugs that it would have fed upon. But their early history was largely unknown, until two new species were named this month. Xiyunykus and Bannykus are two of the most basal members of the Alverezsaurs clan, making them very unique as they still have three fingers, but the beginning of the enlargement of a single finger. This helps us to understand how this kind of niche was able to be filled during the Cretaceous period, and how it might adapt and change in the modern day, with species like anteaters and pangolins taking up this position in different places, and with some of those species being very heavily endangered. The early evolution of turtles during the Triassic has been a hard subject to study, with very few fossil turtles coming from the time period. Now this changed a few years ago with the discovery of Papocheilus, however it has continued to change even up until today. Flat-bodied but without a shell, Eorhynchochelys is the first turtle to have evolved a toothless beak. The fossil also helped to establish whether or not turtles are anapsids or diapsids, with diapsids including our modern-day snakes, lizards, and crocodiles, whereas anapsids are a group of older reptiles which are now extinct. The fossil turtle skull was found to have two holes in the back of its head for musculature, something found in diapsids, meaning that the now anapsid-like skulls of our modern-day turtles is a trait that evolved later into their evolution. Between Papocheilus, the older species that had more of a shell but a toothed mouth, and Eorhynchochelys having a beak but no shell, it helps us to understand how evolution can take very divergent paths on closely related species, at least until the most successful form, our modern-day turtles, was able to evolve with a combination of traits from both of these species. A new species of pterosaur named Caelestiventus has also been described coming from Utah. It's been found to be very closely related to Dimorphodon, which, when you see their skull shape, makes a lot of sense. And this skull was very well preserved. And it has a few notable traits. For example, the largest hole on it, in the front there, is the nostril. However, by examining the brain case, it doesn't seem to have been used for much, as the olfactory lobe of the brain, which dictates how well a species can smell, was actually very small. Meanwhile, the species had very developed optical lobes, meaning it likely relied much more heavily on sight. Because of this, it's believed that the larger nose hole was likely an attempt to help lighten the head to make flight easier for the species. Additionally on the skull, there was a small flange of bone near the back of it, which could have supported something like a turkey's wattle or a pouch somewhat similar to that of the pelican. The environment from which the species was found in was that of a desert, making it one of the earliest desert-going pterosaurs that we know of, and helping us understand just how widespread the pterosaurs were able to become before the end of the Triassic. Hi everyone, thanks for watching. I want to give a shout out again to the museum in Brazil which burned down. Just keep your eye on the news, see if there's anything that does come up where we can try and help them. There's gonna be a lot of finds that were destroyed in that fire. It really just goes to show again how important it is that we donate and fund our museums. Take care, be safe, don't go extinct.